Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Amazon Web Services Partner Webinar Series. Our topic today is Deliver High Availability and Security in Your Cloud Environment. I'm your host, Maya Kabasi, with the Partner Marketing Team here in Seattle. I'd like to start with a couple of housekeeping items. We are recording today's webinar, and while lines are muted, you can submit questions anytime during the presentation. Use the Q&A widget in your browser to do so, and we'll take time for questions at the end. In addition, the presentation will be available for on-demand. You may find our webinar recordings and materials available on AWS YouTube channels. Let's welcome our presenters. Chris Noel, VP of Product Management with AlertLogic, and Ryan Holland, Ecosystem Solutions Architect with Amazon Web Services. On the agenda today, we will begin with Ryan Holland, who will provide Amazon Web Services security overview, and pass the mic to Chris Noel, who will talk about securing your data in the cloud with a shared responsibility model. We will wrap up with a Q&A. So without further delay, let me turn it over to Ryan Holland, Ecosystem Solutions Architect with Amazon Web Services. Take it away, Ryan.
Thanks, Maya. And thank you, everyone, for joining us this morning. And so, like Maya mentioned, we'll start with just giving an overview of the security model for AWS. And our security model is one of a shared responsibility. And we look at this in three different components. So we look at both the infrastructure security, the security of the underlying services that you're running within AWS, and then the application security of the operating system and the applications that, customers are running. The first two of those, the infrastructure security and the security of the underlying services, are all the responsibility of Amazon. So we're responsible for securing the physical security of our data centers, the networking security, all the way up through the virtualization layer, where the responsibility gets handed off to the customer. So everything up to the operating system will be the responsibility of Amazon to secure, and then everything above the hypervisor, so starting at the operating system all the way up through the applications, is going to be the responsibility of the customer to secure. And this is where our partner ecosystem provides a lot of value for our customers in providing solutions that help them fulfill that part of their responsibility. So I'm going to start now and give an overview of how Amazon handles security for both our infrastructure and some of our services. And then Chris will give and we'll talk about the AlertLogic solution and how that helps customers secure their applications and data. So if we start at the very lowest level, the physical security of our data centers, we've been building and maintaining large-scale data centers for many, many years. Even before AWS, Amazon obviously had quite a number of large data centers that it ran as well. And we have some consistent attributes across all of our data centers. There are going to always be nondescript facilities. You'll never see a big Amazon sign on one of our data centers. We have very strong perimeter controls, and we have very strict controls over who gets physical access inside these data centers. And the end of the day, you have to have a good business reason to be allowed into our data centers. Employees or customers that don't have a valid business reason for being in the data centers, if it's not part of your job, essentially, you're not going to be permitted to enter the data center. Any and all access to the data centers is audited and logged, and those logs are reviewed. And we also maintain some strict separation of duties for the people who do have access to the data center. And effectively, if you have access to the physical data centers, you're not allowed to have logical access to the control plane or the systems that manage the data center. And then conversely, if you have logical access to the control plane, you're not allowed to have physical access to our data centers. One of the key tenets of security is also availability. And we design all of our data centers for what we call continuous availability. So we don't have a DR site, right? We don't do active-passive, right? All of our data centers are designed to be always on and always available. And we encourage our customers to design their applications to be scalable and fault-tolerant and leverage multiple data centers within a region that we refer to those as availability zones. All of our availability zones in every region globally are all managed to the same exact standards. and have the same exact audit scope as well. They always have very robust internet connectivity from multiple redundant tier one providers, as well as multiple redundancies for things like power as well. All of our configuration management is done in a way that will not impact end customers. Any changes to our data center software is done in such a fashion that we don't have to take an entire data center offline, right? So you'll never see a maintenance window for one of our regions or one of our availability zones. And any changes that we do employ are always going to be go through a very rigorous change management process where the changes are reviewed, logged, tested, and ultimately go through a very rigorous approval process before that they're deployed out to our data centers. And we do have our status health dashboard where you can see any and all the services that we offer and their current availability status. So if we move up the stack a little bit into the EC2 service itself, when you look at securing that service, we kind of need to break this up into two different parts. So we have what we look at is the host security and then the guest operating security. So the host operating system, that's the virtualization layer, that's going to be our responsibility to manage. And we do that through specially designed bastion hosts. There's a small number of people who have access to these systems, and they have to authenticate using SSH key pairs that are individual key pairs with multi-factor authentication. All of their access to those systems is logged and audited. And that's how our administrators manage the host operating system. The guest operating system is completely under control of our customers. So we don't have any access to your administrator account or your root login on, if it's Linux. We can't log into your systems. We can't recover your password if you lose your key pair, for example. That is completely under the control of the customer, and therefore that's the responsibility of the customer to manage. All of the systems also come with what we call a security group. It's a mandatory selection that when you launch an instance, you have to attach a security group to it. It acts as an inbound firewall. In VPC, it's inbound and outbound. And by default, security group is deny all. So you have to explicitly go and open the specific ports and the sources that you want to allow traffic from. And these are all controlled and managed by the customers. So one question that we get quite a bit is what happens with storage decommissioning or making sure that there's no data remnants on any of our hard drives. So we have a very thorough process that to decommission any sort of storage media that is in our data centers. So we start out by doing a NIST-validated overwrite if the drive is still operating. And then after it's gone through an overwrite process, we will then degauss it and then physically shred the device as well. If it's an SSD-based device, we just do a shredding because degaussing isn't really effective for SSDs. And we do have quite a number of certifications and audits that we go through, and all of our data centers go through these. I won't go into detail on each of these individual audits or certifications, but if you'd like more information, you can find that on our certification page. We go through a SOC 1, a SOC 2, and SOC 3 audit reports. SOC 1 used to be commonly referred to as the SAS 70. We have the report in the SSA 16 format. We also do a SOC 2 audit for a security report, and starting this year, like I mentioned, we have a SOC 3 report as well. The SOC 1 and SOC 2 reports are available to customers under NDA. The SOC 3 audit report you can find on our webpage. It's public information. We also have an ISO 27001 certification, and we have gone through the PCI DSS to be validated as a level one service provider, which means customers can use our data centers, our services, to transmit, store, and process credit card information. Though it's important to understand as a service provider under PCI DSS, that's validated the services that we're providing. Customers do still need to make sure that their application and the way that their application handles data complies with the PCI DSS as well. Our U.S. data centers, all of them, including our GovCloud and our public regions, have gone through the FedRAMP process, and we also have FISMA moderate ATOs as well. Our GovCloud region on the West Coast has ITAR compliance as well. So I want to talk now a little bit about a couple services that I want to highlight that give customers a lot of good security benefits that we recommend folks take advantage of. And the first one is our identity and access management system. So this is all around access to the AWS console and our APIs. So it allows you to create specific users and groups and give very fine-grained levels of permissions to those users as to which API calls they can issue. And then recently we've made an update to this that you can actually now get even more fine-grained on those policies and allow people to issue certain API calls only on certain types of resources as well. But it is important to understand that our identity and access management is only for the control of our infrastructure and access to the AWS console or our APIs. This is not to be used for managing or storing identities for your applications or your operating systems. One of the key services that we highly recommend people to use is that's part of IAM is also our multi-factor authentication. So this works with both your root account as well as your IAM users. And we have multiple form factors for this. So we have the physical tokens that you can give. You see a picture of a Gemalto token there. We also have a virtual MFA service on for Android devices. And there's also, you can use the Google Authenticator app or really any TOTP compliant virtual MFA device. And that's available for no cost. One of the other services that helps customers greatly with security is our virtual private cloud service. So all new customers now will have VPC enabled by default. Customers with older accounts can still choose to launch into what we call EC2 Classic or into VPC. VPC creates a logically isolated environment for the customer. So everything that's inside that VPC is effectively logically isolated from everything else within our environment. It also gives customers a lot more control over the IP space. So when you create a VPC, you define the overall IP space of that VPC, and then you can create subnets within the VPC as well, and you define the IP space for those subnets. So for your existing networking folks, controlling and setting up these VPCs should look very familiar to them. It also gives you the ability to create network ACLs, so access control lists that you can apply to subnets, and so you can isolate certain subnets from other subnets, which again is very similar to how you would control network access in an on-premise environment. There's several different means of connecting those VPCs. You can connect them directly to the internet, but you can also use our VPC VPN service where you can connect and extend your existing on-premise environment into your VPC over an IPsec tunnel or through Direct Connect, which is a low-latency fiber connection from some partner colos that we partner with. One other option that you also have in VPC is dedicated instances. This is a means of getting a further level of isolation for customers that have compliance needs or just want a higher level of isolation. And with VPC dedicated instances, what will happen is we won't put any other customers on the physical hardware that's running your instances. There is an additional charge for leveraging dedicated instances. It's a $2 flat fee per region. So if you launch one or 100 instances within a particular region that are marked as dedicated, then it's just a single two-hour flat fee for enabling that, plus a small hourly charge per instance. And you can do that on a per-instance basis, or you can also mark an entire VPC as dedicated, and then any instances that customers launch in that VPC will be on dedicated hosts. So I just want to wrap up and give some other information for customers to go find. I want to point you to our Security and Compliance Center. You can see the URL on the top of the slide. There's a whole host of information there that has a lot of good security and privacy questions. It's where we also post any of our security bulletins. and a lot of good information on security best practices. I do want to call out two of the white papers that are on there that people get a lot of value from. The first one is the security white paper, and this goes through in a lot more detail a lot of the information I talked over, plus several other different services, and really describes our security process and how we manage security within our environment. There's also our risk and compliance white paper, which looks at several different compliance regimes and describes how to build environments within AWS that can meet all of those compliance requirements. The other part of the risk and compliance white paper that's quite nice is at the end of it in the appendix, there's the CSA, the Cloud Security Alliance, questionnaire that we've answered all of the questions for and provided that to customers as well. Okay, with that, I want to hand it over to Chris at Alert Logic.
Thanks, Ryan. So I'll pick up where Ryan left off with the shared security model, the shared security model, and specifically what Alert Logic does to help customers with their portion of that model. So a lot of times when we talk about security, we're thinking specifically of confidentiality, and I think that's a trap that we can fall into of thinking about PHI, PII, legal liability to third parties, protecting your own IP. Certainly all those considerations are an important aspect of security, but what can often get neglected is availability. And Ryan mentioned a lot of great things that Amazon does to ensure availability, but there is one aspect that I think is often overlooked, and that's your ability to recover in the event that you do have a security incident and it's unclear to you exactly when that security incident took place and what actually was done, what data was changed, what systems were altered, and thus it becomes difficult to define a recovery point and continue with your operations. So it's important to think of security as really spanning the traditional CIA triad, and this has been a security concept for years and years, but just as relevant today as it was when it was invented. And that's thinking about confidentiality or limiting access just to authorized users, integrity, maintaining the trustworthiness of the data that you're processing and the systems that process it, and then availability, keeping those services that you've worked so hard to develop online and available to your customers. So with that as kind of a requirements background, we'll talk about specific security solutions and the requirements for those. And really we like to think, and we'll frame this up in terms of prevention and detection, and those being two necessary elements to any good security model. And so on the prevention side, the goal is to block the attacks. But you can't really ever completely block the attackers. You can delay compromise, but you can never completely prevent it. We think of prevention controls as primarily shrinking the attack surface, shrinking the target, if you will, so that it takes longer and it's more complicated for a committed adversary to breach you. And then on the detection side, that becomes sort of the necessary partner in this is you've invested in the prevention controls to sort of hold off the attack. You now need to monitor the environment, see when those aggressive attempts are being made, and be in a position to take countermeasures before it's too late, or even if you are compromised, be able to contain that quickly. And sometimes it's helpful to refer back to a physical security analogy. Sometimes information security can get kind of abstract. And so, you know, if you think about securing a warehouse or some other lights out facility, it's important not only to have locks on the doors, but an alarm system. Certainly an unattended lock, unmonitored lock, can be broken with a crowbar, and if you give someone an infinite amount of time, the warehouse is going to be empty when you finally show up the next morning. You need to pair those two to have effective defense. And that's really how we think about security and how we think about instrumenting our customers' environments and providing that layered defense, is you start with actively monitored preventative controls to block the attackers and slow them down. You then add in the monitoring of the environment, systems, and applications to understand what's actually going on and what attacker activity there is. And then you collect and analyze log data not only to inform your understanding of what's going on in the environment, but in the event that you're compromised, to be able to understand who did what when and have that good point of restoration pre-attack. And so if you think about that in the context of AWS and the services they provide a lot of great foundational services, the physical security of the infrastructure like Ryan talked about, and a lot of network and host security. So there's relatively less for you to do than there could be in other environments. And I think that's one of the misnomers that we see with public cloud is, and AWS in particular, is a lot of times the press is that there are security issues with it, and there certainly are. There's security issues with anything in life. But in fact, from our own studies across our 2,200 customers, and I highly encourage you to download our cloud security report, you'll see that cloud infrastructures are, in fact, experience fewer attacks and, most importantly, fewer successful attacks than on-premise infrastructures. So a lot of the good work that AWS is doing to secure your environment, it pays off, and we've seen that empirically. But nevertheless, there's still attacks that are made against your environment, whether those are happen at the network layer, the host layer, or the application layer. That's just a fact of life of being on the internet these days. And there's in the blue, we show really what we deem to be additional measures that are client responsibilities that you need to consider as you're constructing your security solution on top of the great foundation that AWS provides. And so a lot of that's going to be the monitoring controls specific to your environment, but it's also a matter of taking advantage of some of the services that Ryan mentioned, taking advantage of the security groups and really being thoughtful about how you go about locking down ports and IPs just to the very minimum of what's required inbound and outbound to run your business. Again, it's that preventative control concept of shrinking the attack surface to the bare minimum so that you're not presenting a larger target than you need to be. Same thing's true at the host level. When you think about OS practices and what you need to do to harden the guest OS, all the same practices you'd follow in other environments equally apply here in terms of getting that image hardening in place, stripping out the guest account out of a Microsoft installation, logging in with sudo versus direct root access. All those traditional security best practices apply, as well as some of the monitoring and log analysis techniques that I referred to earlier. And then if there's anything that we want to really focus on and hopefully have you take away from this presentation, it's the criticality of the app layer. That's where most of the vulnerabilities are that we see today. That's where most of the attacks are. And again, if you download that cloud security report, you'll see that that's empirically proven across our 2,200 customers and the monitoring we do there. And really any third-party study you find today is going to confirm that. So we'll spend the bulk of our time talking about what needs to be done there at the application layer to secure your environment. So before I get into the specifics of what we can do to help, really at Alert Logic, there's sort of three things to understand about us, our brand, and our solutions. First is that our focus is on delivering security and compliance outcomes, not products. So we'll go into all the elements that's required to deliver a security solution, but it's a lot more than the technology unless you as the customer want to provide all those additional operational and technology components required to secure an environment. And we believe that, especially in the cloud, a lot of customers want to offload that to a provider and get a complete solution and not have to be operationally engaged with their security solution. The other thing is focus. As you're looking at security solutions, it's important to understand the focus of the vendor and find people who are aligned with the environments that you're going into. A cloud environment looks very different from a threat perspective than an on-premise campus environment where you have a lot more user activity because it's a workstation-oriented environment or a BYOD-oriented environment as opposed to a locked-down data center with web applications. And so understanding, finding a vendor who understands the threat perspectives and can help you with your your specific environment is important. And then the third is that, again, security as a service model where we're providing a complete solution and not just a product and doing it on a subscription basis. So in terms of AWS and our partnership there, we run on AWS. We have our AMIs or AMIs, however you choose to pronounce it, and agent deployment options. So we're completely deployable within AWS. But more importantly, we're engineered for AWS. And I think this is what helps set us apart is we support a lot of AWS concepts like auto-scaling. And we'll get into, particularly for web application security, why auto-scaling is so critical. We support automation with APIs and scripts, so the same type of tooling that you're going to use for managing your Amazon infrastructure can be ported to your security solution. We recognize that the cloud environments are different from traditional network environments. Topology changes, IP addresses change. Traditional security tools have really used those concepts as fixed constants and provide all the reporting and output in those terms. We've had to re-engineer our stack from the ground up to be cloud native and to discard those notions of identity so that our customers can get results that are meaningful in a cloud context and easy to manage. We want to do business like the cloud. So if you are using a combination of reserved and on-demand instances, you should get the same model from your security solution. That's something that we support today. You can sign up for a fixed commitment for your base load and then have a variable usage-based component for that on-demand component of your workload. And then it should be marketplace transactable, and we've been in the Amazon marketplace since its launch and are very excited about our the opportunities that's opened up to us. So in thinking through a security solution, there's really four elements involved, whether it's ours or someone else's, and really independent of the layer we're talking about, whether it's a network security solution, a system security solution, or an application security solution. And that, quite simply, is the actual security technology itself, and usually in a layered defense approach that involves both preventative and detective controls, that's going to involve multiple technologies. The platform you process it through, most of those technologies are going to produce really an ocean of data, and so having a system that can correlate that data, analyze it, and reduce it down to a set of actionable inputs or outputs, becomes important. Having the people in place in a security operations center to action those outputs, and then have the current fresh content to keep up with the latest threats. I mean, one thing that sets security apart from other fields is that we have an active adversary who changes tactics to match the defenses that are conducted. And so it's important to be able to keep up with that and continually evolve your security solution over time. So in terms of how we do that, we provide three solutions that mix detection and active defense that are deployable in the cloud, Amazon Web Services in particular, and that include both management and a software as a service model. We have a platform that analyzes and performs multi-factor correlation across those data sets. Today we consume millions of security events a second and are able to produce actionable output for our security operations center to action. And then having people who can respond. So we staff our security operations centers 24/7 so that we can respond in near real time to attacks and hopefully minimize the damage or even prevent the attack from being successful in the first place by enabling you or us on your behalf to conduct an active defense. And then finally combining that with a research team that consists of a variety of skill sets. It's no longer enough to have your white hats performing that research. Increasingly, it's a data scientist-driven activity, people who are math majors looking for those anomalies and who can get paired with those white hats to produce the best algorithms to detect not only things we know about today, but the things around the corner. And we'll get into some of those zero-day threats and how we can help protect your environment from them in a couple slides here. So in terms of specific offerings we have at AWS, Threat Manager is going to be a foundational item. It's your detective controls as well as a preventative technology with the scanning. So today we analyze billions of events a day to be able to identify real incidents that's processed by our Security Operations Center and turned into actionable findings for our customers. We also pair that with vulnerability scanning so that as you're hardening your environment, you can proactively probe that environment to see if there's any open doors that you've forgotten to close in the process. Certainly, that's not a point-in-time activity. That's an ongoing thing as the world evolves. And so having a regular vulnerability scan can be an important part of your configuration hardening process and help you maintain that security. Log Manager is another product that's available in AWS, another service. So in addition to collecting and archiving and enabling you to search your logs like any log management technology, we also provide security and compliance value add on top of that by our expert system and ultimately our Security Operations Center. So we go far beyond just giving you a console that you can do searches from. We have a team that is dedicated to combing through your log data and identifying any suspicious behavior and ultimately escalating it to you and drawing it to your attention when it appears critical. And finally, Web Security Manager. Web Security Manager is our newest product to AWS, and I'll spend the rest of the time talking about it. It addresses the most important threat that I referred to earlier, the web application attacks. And it was launched within the last week, so hot off the presses here. So in terms of why would I say that web application attacks are absolutely the most important thing and the first thing to focus on as you think about your AWS environment, at least if you're deploying a web application at AWS? It starts with the fact that the vulnerabilities are common. 86% of custom web apps contain SQL injection attacks. That was from a study by HP. And in fact, if 86% contain SQL injection, I would suspect that they also contain other vulnerabilities, since SQL injection is one of the most well understood and one of the easiest to prevent. So that really is just the tip of the iceberg. And it comes from the fact that very few organizations actually consistently test their web applications for security holes. According to this study, 72% of organizations test less than 10% of their web applications for security holes. And as a result, the average website has 79 serious vulnerabilities, which we almost never see that on the network and host side. It would be an extreme outlier to see an Internet-facing environment that had that number of network and OS vulnerabilities in any context. This is really unique these days to web applications, and it's understandable. Developers are under pressure to meet deadlines. QA groups generally aren't staffed with security experts who can do the security testing. And so as a result, you often have these vulnerabilities going into production. And unfortunately, it's just a matter of time until an application is compromised in that case. And that brings us really to the top point here, which is that we are, in fact, seeing these attacks in the wild. Depends on the study that you read, but anywhere from high 70s to, in this case, 97% of breaches are attributed to web vulnerabilities. After all, attackers aren't fools. They see the same studies that I referred to below, and they know that that's the easiest path for them to go down and the most fruitful, ultimately. From our own studies, we see that half of the environments we monitor will be impacted by web application attacks 30 times in a year. Hopefully they have the right preventative controls to fend those off, but applications are under assault, and if you're doing business on the web, you can assume that you are too, or you will be over time. So to dramatize this and talk about this, a very, very simple example of a SQL injection attack. We'll start with a shopping cart application as a sample, and hopefully your shopping cart's a little bit more visually appealing and sophisticated than this one, but just to make the point, here a consumer's looking for a coat and has selected a fleece jacket. The application is now going to produce two parameters, a group ID and an item ID. Those get passed into the application. So no harm so far, just a normal transaction. Where the harm comes in is if that input isn't validated, a malicious person can inject additional SQL statements in there, in this case to drop the table named products. Certainly not something that you'd want to happen to your application, hopefully something that your application wouldn't allow. What we typically see is that people are at least somewhat aware of these type of attacks today, but they may not have systematically implemented parameter validation across all the different inputs within their application, and unfortunately it only takes one or maybe a few places in there for the attacker to find that opening. So where Web Security Manager enters in is it's effectively in a preventative control that sits in line. It sits behind the network firewall, in the case of AWS, behind the security group configuration that you've implemented with the port and IP restrictions. In the case of port and IP network firewall type of restrictions, the limitation of that technology is that, you know, if you're operating a website, you're typically going to allow anyone access via 80 and 443 so that you can conduct business. That's just a business requirement, and the type of attack I just showed wouldn't be blocked and couldn't be blocked by a network firewall without blocking your customers from accessing your shopping cart in that case. Web Security Manager provides an additional layer of protection because it's protocol aware. It can be able to differentiate malicious traffic from legitimate traffic and only pass the legitimate traffic to the web server. So we'll talk a little bit about how that's done. And it's really done through a combination of factors. It's done through negative security and positive security models. On the negative security side, when you first install it, it's going to filter out known attacks. Things like SQL injection are well-recognized patterns and, in general, can be blocked out of the box with a certain base set of content. But that's generally not sufficient for an application. That blocks the things that we know about today. It doesn't restrict, though, the universe of things that could, of attacks that could potentially be conducted in the future. And so that's really where positive security comes in. Positive security is more like a network firewall model where you're saying deny everything except for these specific allowed things. And the way that works in a web application context is we go about learning the behavior of the application, learning what legitimate traffic is, and then creating a model where we screen everything out that doesn't fit that specific pattern that your application requires. And that's probably worth a little bit of explanation. That's really a three-step process where the learning engine that builds that positive security model analyzes application activity, recommends a security policy change, and then that policy is validated by one of our web application security experts and ultimately is approved by the customer. Want to obviously do no harm in putting something in line, so want to be conservative and run it through really three levels of validation, automatic validation, the human validation by one of our analysts, and then ultimately the customer validation. And so in terms of the automatic validation and how that happens, we start with the application, in this case the show item application. It's going to look at the specific parameters and abstract out, in this case, two parameters, group and item. It's then going to look at the values for a given transaction, in this case, 10 and 45, 34. And then it's going to start to build an inference about what legitimate inputs are. In this case, group appears to be numeric and item appears to be numeric. But that needs to be validated based on large samples of data. So we're going to look at transactions over a period of time and literally thousands of transactions, process that data in batches, and develop a high degree of confidence about what's normal for your given application. And so this is, in the end, the conclusion that can be drawn based on the sample set of data. So again, this conclusion that the learning engine drew was that group inputs are always numeric, and that the vast majority of time, item inputs are numeric. And so that'll end up becoming the recommended policy that'll then go through the validation and approval process I described. And what's really critical is the nuance associated with this. So it can't just be a very simple, dumb process where you build a list effectively. So if you allow commas, then the question should be asked of, do you allow other punctuation? Another example would be SQL injection is often going to use a single quote as in its syntax. Using a single quote is the only mechanism by which you identify SQL injection is a really poor practice, because if you have a customer, specifically in this case an Irish customer with a name like O'Malley or O'Connor, you could very well end up impacting his ability or her ability to input their name in a name field. So there has to be some judgment applied both within the automated learning mechanism as well as by the analyst to be able to ensure that you're building an effective policy. And so once that policy is built, then it needs to be validated across, again, more traffic to be able to identify whether that, in fact, is effective or whether it has unintended consequences. And then at the end of the process, what you end up with is a very effective way of reducing your attack surface without recoding your application. So you end up being able to shrink that attack surface dramatically and thus make your environment quite a bit more secure. In terms of the architecture of the application and how it gets deployed at AWS, this is one of the things that we're most excited about and where we did the most engineering on building a cloud-native application for AWS. We didn't just take our standard web security manager, our standard web application firewall, and port it and create an image. We wanted to engineer it into the AWS fabric so that it would be deployed like you'd expect an AWS service to be deployed. And so we highly leveraged services like Elastic Load Balancer to accomplish that. And specifically, when we think of auto-scaling is a critical requirement for an inline technology that sits in front of your web servers. Whether you're deploying auto-scaling today or whether that's an aspiration in the future, you probably don't want to deploy a technology that creates a potential bottleneck in the system and that thus has to be significantly over-provisioned as opposed to something that where you can deploy just enough capacity to meet your typical needs and then auto-scale that as demand picks up. And so that's exactly what we've done, again, leveraging ELB technology as we've built this auto-scaling WAF that enables you to get just enough capacity and spend just the minimum amount of money to be able to operate your environment in a secure fashion. So to kind of sum up some of the critical points, need a mix of preventative and detective controls. If you're going to start somewhere, again, it's particularly for a web application in a cloud environment, we would highly recommend starting with web application security, whether it's our product or someone else's. That's really where the bulk of the attacks are, and that's typically where we see customers having the weakest defenses. So, again, one of the reasons why we're so excited to be able to offer WSM or Web Security Manager in an AWS context. What you can expect from Alert Logic, we designed our technologies for AWS environments, as I've spoken about a number of times here. We deliver outcomes, not products. We ultimately measure ourselves based on the quality of the intelligence we're providing and the quality of the prevention that we're offering, not based on being able to ship a product to you. We like to deliver results in minutes, So being able to deploy a product via marketplace, being able to deploy it in a fashion that you would expect from a public cloud product, and give you flexibility to grow. So have that auto-scaling capability, give you that on-demand scalability, give you the ability to meter your service both in terms of a base load and then an on-demand usage-based component. Today, we protect over 2,200 customers, ranging from SMBs to name brands that everyone would recognize across really every industry, as one might expect with a security and compliance provider. In terms of third-party recognition and being able to trust our solutions, Forrester's recognized us as a leader in security. You can see their quadrant here. And then Gartner actually called us out specifically in their cool vendor study that for our Amazon-based services. And so we would encourage you to learn more. We've got a specific web link here, and then would love to conduct a demo or showcase some of our technologies and talk through how they may fit your specific requirements. So with that, I'll wrap up and we can open it up for questions.
Thank you all for demonstrating how to deliver high availability and security in your cloud environment. I already see some questions from our audience. I would like to point my first question to you, Ryan. Do you make available to your customers reports that summarize monthly activity in terms of threats and other security events?
So we don't make a monthly report. We do have a security bulletin section on our security and compliance website. So if you go to aws.amazon.com/security and you look under the security bulletin section, you'll see any security bulletins that we've issued.
Also, for you, Ryan, one of our attendees is asking, where can I find the AWS Cloud Security Report?
So I'm not 100% sure what you're referring to by the Cloud Security Report. You might be referring to the CSA report that I mentioned, the Cloud Security Alliance report. So if you go to our security and compliance webpage, again, that's the aws.amazon.com/security, in the risk and compliance white paper is our CSA questionnaire that we've answered, as well as some other white papers on there as well regarding security.
Thanks, Ryan. I would like to answer the next question, actually, because I've been getting that question a lot today. Where can we get all of the slides? The slides are not available for distribution. However, the presentation is available for on-demand viewership, and you will receive an email tomorrow with a link where you can view it again. My next question is for AlertLogic. Chris? With auto-scaling, how does AlertLogic help facilitate obtaining all the logs from the host?
Sure. So with auto-scaling in our log manager solution, as I assume the one that is being referred to, we actually can bake our agents in, and those agents can be deployed in what we call a role configuration. So as that host auto-scales up, it will include our agent and be able to communicate logs back to our back end no matter how many instances are spun up. One thing that's really critical to understand about that is we do have the host metadata thanks to AWS's APIs. So if you're interested in which specific host those logs came from, that's available to you, as well as if you're more interested in looking at it as, again, a role. So you have a group of web servers as an example. They're really all identical and performing the same function, have the exact same configuration, almost by definition, since they're being auto-scaled. You can also look at the data that way and look at it as a superset thanks to those role agents.
Thanks, Chris. And is the web application protection going while listing or blacklisting?
So, great question. It's actually both. And again, I think of the negative security model as more of a blacklist model where you're defining rules as to what looks like SQL injection and then not allowing that as an example. The positive security model then supplements that by working through an analysis process like I described and being able to identify what legitimate traffic looks like and then building a policy that basically disallows all other traffic. So that's how we go from, I think, a good preventative solution to a great preventative solution is through that learning process.
Thanks, Chris. One more question to you. Where is the web security agent deployed? At customer side or is it a cloud service?
So great question. It's an inline technology, so it's deployed actually in the customer's environment, and it's actually not an agent in that case. It's an appliance, so it's got its own AMI or AMI, however you happen to say it, and again, it has that auto-scaling capability, so we at least recommend our customers set up ELB configurations so that those appliances auto-scale along with the rest of their environment and can keep up with really any conceivable traffic load.
Thanks, Chris. I would like to point the next question to Ryan. Does AWS partner with any virtual firewall providers for clients that have requirements for traditional firewalls with packet layer inspection instead of a security group restrictions in the VPC?
Yes, sir. So you can use really any virtual firewall on the host itself. So the AlertLogic Threat Manager actually can help you get some packet inspection as well. If you're looking for like a perimeter firewall, we have several that we partner with, like Sophos and Checkpoint. But realistically, any kind of virtual firewall that runs either in the guest or as an AMI would work for that requirement.
Thanks, Ryan. My next question is for Chris. How do you comply with federal continuous monitoring requirements?
You know, honestly, I will not take a stab at that one. I have an associate that sits on the audit and compliance side of the business who I'm sure would love to answer that question in all its gory detail, but I'm more suited to answer some of the technology and product questions, and I'll defer to him on that. But I believe we have people's questions, and we can certainly follow up on that.
Certainly. The questions that we won't be able to answer today, mostly of time reasons, will be answered later via email by AlertLogic, so do not be concerned if we don't get to your questions. I have one more question for you, Chris. How can AlertLogic help in processing requests coming to our ELB and drop the request quickly so that it doesn't take up much resources?
So great question. I certainly wouldn't say that the primary benefit of Web Security Manager is as a DDoS mitigation solution, but it can perform some of that role. So it generally is more scalable than most people's web servers and applications, and as a filter on the front end can intercept that traffic and drop it before it ever gets to your web servers. And that is a solution that people have configured and deployed successfully to prevent real-world attacks. Would want to probably follow up with you and talk through specifically what concerns you might have to make sure that we're the best fit for what you're looking for there.
Thanks, Chris. I have one more question for you. This is related to pricing. In general, how is pricing structured for the subscription services? Does security incident management incur additional fees?
So there's one price for our services. So incident management, all aspects of the service are kind of rolled into that either utility-based price or monthly price, depending upon which model our customer opts for, models, if they want to mix those two. And then it just depends on the service as to how that is metered, whether it's metered in terms of network traffic in the case of Threat Manager or appliance instances or nodes. There's a variety of pricing models. Again, we try to fit our customers' use case as closely as possible.
Thank you, Chris. I would like to point one final question to you. Is Log Agent deployed on the same EC2 machine?
So the Log Agent is deployed on whatever systems you want to collect logs from. So yes, it would. In most cases, it's going to be deployed on each EC2 instance in your environment.
Thank you very much, and that's it for our questions today. You can contact AlertLogic or AWS, and you will receive an email tomorrow with a link to view the presentation on demand. Here's some information for you for contact. And I would like to thank our presenters, Chris from AlertLogic and Ryan from AWS, and our attendees. Thank you very much for taking the time to join us. Thank you for being active in your questions. And before you log off, please take a short survey. It's very short, just so we can improve our webinar offerings. Just click the link that appears on your website, on your browser, and it will take you to the survey. And this concludes our joint webinar today. Thank you very much for attending. Have a nice day.